Will didn't know how seriously you're supposed to take these questionnaire things, but he couldn't afford to think about it. Being Men's Magazine cool was as close as he had ever come to an achievement, and moments like this were to be treasured. Will wondered sometimes how people like him would have survived 60 years ago. People, that is, who didn't really do anything all day, and didn't want to do anything either. 60 years ago, all the things Will relied on to get him through the day simply didn't exist. There was no daytime TV, no videos, no glossy magazines, and therefore no questionnaires, and the kind of music he listened to hadn't even been invented yet. Right now, he was listening to Nirvana and Snoop Doggy Dogg, which would have left books. Books! He would have had to get a job. Now, though, you didn't have to have a life of your own anymore. You could just peek over the fence at other people's lives, as lived in newspapers and EastEnders and films and exquisitely sad jazz or tough rap songs. The 20-year-old Will would have been surprised and perhaps disappointed to learn that he would reach the age of 36 without finding a life for himself, but the 36-year-old Will wasn't unhappy about it. There was less clutter this way. Clutter? Will's friend John's house was full of it. John and Christine had two children. The second had been born the previous week, and Will had been summoned to look at it. And their place was a disgrace. Pieces of brightly coloured plastic all over the floor. Videotapes out of their cases near the TV set. How could people live like this? Christine came in holding the new baby. This is Imogen. Oh, said Will. Right. What was he supposed to say next? He concentrated his conversational efforts on Christine. How are you anyway, Chris? You know, a bit washed out. Been burning the candle at both ends. No, just had a baby. Oh, right. That would make you pretty tired, I guess. John came in with a tray and three mugs of tea. Barney's gone to his grandma's today, he said, for no reason at all that Will could see. How is Barney? Barney was two. That was how Barney was, and therefore of no interest to anyone apart from his parents. He's not too sure what to make of Imogen, but he's lovely. Will had met Barney before, and knew for a fact he wasn't lovely. What about you, Will? Any desire for a family of your own yet? I would rather eat one of Barney's dirty nappies, he thought. Not yet, he said. These two were beginning to make him feel physically ill. John and Christine used to be okay. When Will had been going out with Jessica, the four of them used to go out clubbing. Jessica and Will split up when Jessica wanted to exchange frivolity for something more solid. Will had missed her, temporarily, but he would have missed the clubbing more. Now John and Christine had taken the Jessica route to oblivion, he wouldn't be bothering with them again. During the night after his first day at school, Marcus woke up every half hour or so. He couldn't believe he was going to have to go back there the next morning, and the morning after that. Every time he woke up, his first thought was that there must be some kind of way around this horrible feeling. But there wasn't. He just wasn't right for schools. That was the basic problem. He already knew he wasn't right for parties, because he was too shy, or for baggy trousers, because his legs were too short. But not being right for school was a big problem. He got to school early and went to his form room. He was safe enough there. The kids who'd given him a hard time yesterday were probably not the sort to arrive at school first thing. They'd be off somewhere smoking and taking drugs and raping people. There were a couple of girls in the room, but they ignored him, unless the snort of laughter he heard had anything to do with him. What was there to laugh at? Not much. Unless you were the kind of person who was on permanent lookout for something to laugh at. Unfortunately, that was exactly the kind of person most kids were, in his experience. They patrolled school corridors like sharks, on the lookout for the wrong trousers, or the wrong haircut, or the wrong trainers, any or all of which sent them wild with excitement. As he was usually wearing the wrong trainers or the wrong trousers, and his haircut was wrong all the time, he didn't have to do much to send them demented. Marcus knew that part of the reason he was weird was because his mum was weird. She didn't want him to watch rubbish television or listen to rubbish music or play rubbish computer games, which meant that if he wanted to do anything any of the other kids spent their time doing, he had to argue for hours. He usually lost, and she was so good at arguing that he felt good about losing. She could explain why listening to Joni Mitchell and Bob Marley was much better for him than listening to Snoop Doggy Dogg. And why it was more important to read books than to play on the Game Boy his dad had given him. But he couldn't pass any of this on to the kids at school. If he tried to tell Lee Hartley, the biggest and loudest and nastiest of the kids he'd met yesterday, that he didn't approve of Snoop Doggy Dogg because Snoop Doggy Dogg had a bad attitude to women, Lee Hartley would thump him. It wasn't all his mum's fault. Sometimes he was weird just because of who he was. Like the singing. He always had a tune in his head, but every now and again, when he was nervous, the tune just sort of slipped out. The song had slipped out yesterday during English, while the teacher was reading. If you wanted to make people laugh at you, really, really laugh, then the best way was to sing out loud when everybody else in the room was quiet and bored. This morning in English, things went bad again. They were looking at a bit taken from One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest. He'd seen the film, and so he could see really clearly what was going to happen. Ms. Maguire tried to get a discussion going. Now, one of the things this book is about is, how do we know who's mad and who isn't? Because if someone decides that we're a bit mad, how do we show them we're sane?
Silence.
Okay, let's put it another way. How can we tell if people are mad? Here it comes, he thought. If they sing for no reason in class, miss. Laughter. But then it all got worse than he'd expected. He looked at Ms. Maguire. She had this big forced grin on and she wouldn't catch his eye. That's one way of telling yes, but leaving Marcus out of it for a moment. More laughter. He knew what she was doing and why. And he hated her. Will first saw Angie, or as it turned out, he didn't see her, in Championship Vinyl, a little record shop off the Holloway Road. He was browsing when he heard her tell the surly assistant that she was looking for a Pinky and Perky record for her niece. He saw a lot of honey blonde hair, and he heard the kind of vaguely husky voice that he and everyone else thought of as sexy. So he listened while she explained that her niece didn't even know who Pinky and Perky were. Don't you think that's terrible? What are they teaching these kids? She was met with a withering look of contempt and a mumble, which indicated that she was wasting the assistant's valuable time. 2 days later, he found himself sitting next to the same woman in a cafe on Upper Street. He recognized her voice. They both ordered a cappuccino and croissant, the hair and her denim jacket. They both got up to get one of the cafe's newspapers, and he smiled. I like Pinky and Perky, he said, in what he hoped was a friendly and humorous tone. But he could see immediately that he'd made a terrible mistake, that this was not the same woman. She looked at him and smiled nervously. I'm sorry, he said. I thought you were someone else. He blushed, and the blush seemed to relax her. I know this sounds nosy, she said, but who did you think I was? I've been trying to come up with some kind of story, and I can't. So he explained, and she laughed again, and by the time they had finished their second cappuccino, he had a date for dinner. When they met again, she told him about her kids straight away. He wanted to throw his napkin on the floor and run. So, he said, it was the right thing to say. I thought you ought to know. It makes a difference to some people. Thank you, but it's no problem. I would have been disappointed if you didn't have children. She laughed. Why? This was a good question. Obviously, he'd said it because he thought it sounded smooth and winning, but he couldn't tell her that. Because I've never been out with someone who was a mum before, and I've always wanted to. I think I'd be good at it. Good at what? Right, good at what? What was he good at? This was the million-dollar question, the one he'd never been able to answer about anything. Maybe he'd be good at children, even though he hated them. Maybe this was it. Uncle Will. Maybe this was a turning point in his life. I don't know. Good at kids' things. It had to be said that Angie's beauty was not irrelevant to his decision. She was beautiful in a very winning, Julie Christie-type way. And when had he ever been out with a woman who looked like Julie Christie? What was happening here? He decided that children were what was happening here. That children served as a symbolic blemish, which gave him a chance where previously there would have been none. I'll tell you, Angie was saying, although he had missed much of the cogitation that had brought her to this point. When you're a single mother, you're far more likely to end up thinking in feminist cliches, you know, all men are bastards, all that stuff. I'm sure, said Will sympathetically. He was getting excited now. If single mothers really thought that all men were bastards, then he could clean up. He nodded and frowned and pursed his lips while Angie ranted and while he plotted his new life-changing strategy. For the next few weeks, he was Will the good guy, Will the redeemer, and he loved it. It was effortless, too. He'd never managed to strike up much of a rapport with Maisie, Angie's somber 5-year-old, but Joe, the 3-year-old, took to him almost at once, mostly because during their first meeting, Will held him upside down by his ankles. That was all it took. He wished that relationships with proper human beings were that easy. And then there was the sex. Sex with a single mother, Will decided after his first night with Angie, beat the sort of sex he was used to, hands down. If you pick someone who'd been messed around and abandoned by the father of her children, then she loved you for it. All of a sudden you became better looking, a better lover, a better person. As far as he could see, it was an entirely happy arrangement. Even the end had an enormous amount to recommend it. They'd been going out for about 6 weeks, and he was just beginning to wonder whether Angie was exactly what he was looking for when she decided to finish it. They were in an Indian restaurant when she told him, Will, I'm so sorry, but I'm not sure this is working out. It's not you. You've been great. It's me. There are things you don't know. Things about Simon. Is he giving you a hard time? No, not really. He just hasn't come to terms with us splitting up, and I'm not sure I have either. I'm not ready to launch into a relationship with anybody new yet. The tragedy is that I've met someone just right for me at precisely the wrong time. I should have started with a meaningless fling, not with someone who... If she but knew it. If there was a man better equipped for the meaningless fling, he wouldn't like to meet him. I've been putting this on, he wanted to tell her. I'm horrible. I'm much shallower than this, honest. But it was too late. Will, I'm so sorry that... He had never before watched a woman cry without feeling responsible. And he was rather enjoying the experience. Of all the evenings he'd spent with Angie, he loved the last one the best. This, for Will, was the clincher. He knew then there would be other women like Angie. Women who would start off by thinking that they wanted a regular fuck and end up deciding that a quiet life was worth any number of noisy orgasms. Great sex, a lot of ego massage, temporary parenthood without tears, and a guilt-free parting. What more could a man want? His career as a serial nice guy had begun. One Monday morning, his mother started crying before breakfast, and it frightened him. Morning crying was something new, and it was a bad, bad sign. On the way to school, he tried to work out what was wrong with her. She was in work, so they went poor. She was a music therapist, which meant that she was a sort of teacher for children with learning difficulties, and they had enough money for the flat, for food, and for holidays once a year. What else made you cry apart from money? Death? But he'd know if anybody important had died. Men? He knew she wanted a boyfriend, but he knew because she joked about it sometimes, and he couldn't see that it was possible to go from joking about something now and again to crying about it all the time. So what else was there? He tried to remember what people cried about in EastEnders, apart from money, death, and boyfriends, but it wasn't very helpful. Prison sentences, unwanted pregnancies, AIDS, stuff that didn't seem to apply to his mum. Spat. Single parents alone together. Met on the first Thursday of the month in a local adult education centre, and tonight was Will's first time. He was almost sure that tonight would be his last time, too. He'd get something wrong, like the name of Postman Pat's cat, or, more crucially, the name of his own child. He'd only christened him Ned this morning, and he'd be exposed as a fraud. However, it had to be worth a try. The scent had depressed him. He had forgotten that British education smelt of disinfectant. There was only one woman in the room. She was taking bottles of white wine out of a cardboard box and putting them onto a table. It was the most desolate party venue Will had ever seen.
"Are you Will?"
asked the woman.
"I'm Francis."
She looked like Wurzel Gummidge's friend Aunt Sally. He smiled and shook her hand. He had spoken to Francis on the phone earlier in the day.
"I'm sorry there's nobody else here yet. We quite often get off to a slow start. Babysitters."
Of course. He was wrong to be prompt. He rolled his eyes. "Don't talk to me about babysitters." He laughed bitterly. As the other SPAT members, all of them women in their 30s, started to arrive, Francis introduced him to each of them. Sally and Moira, who looked tough, ignored him completely. Lizzie, who was small, sweet, and scatty. Helen and Susanna. And Susie, who was tall, blonde, pale, and nervy-looking, and beautiful. She would do, he thought. "Hello," he said. "I'm Will. I'm new, and I don't know anybody."
"Hello, Will. I'm Susie. I'm old, and I know everybody."
He laughed. She laughed. Susie had been married to a man called Mark, who had started an affair when she was 6 months pregnant and had left her the day before she went into labor. Susie was now poor and bitter, and Will could understand why.
"One of the reasons I like coming here is that you can be angry. Just about everyone's got something they're angry about."
"Really?" They didn't look that angry to Will.
"The woman in the denim shirt over there. Her husband went because he thought their little boy wasn't his. Helen. He went off with someone from work. Moira. He came out.
Aren't there any other men who come to SPAT?" he asked.
"Just one. Jeremy. He's on holiday."
"So women do leave sometimes."
"Jeremy's wife was killed in a car crash."
"Oh."
"I'm sorry," said Susie. "I haven't asked you anything about yourself. Did you get dumped then?"
"Well, I suppose I did, yes." He gave her a stoical smile.
"And does your ex see Ned?"
"Sometimes. She's not that bothered." It was good to be the bearer of bad news about women. True, this bad news was entirely fictitious, but there was, he thought, an emotional truth here somewhere.
"How does he cope with that?"
"Oh, he's very brave.
They have amazing resources, kids, don't they?"
His astonishment, he found himself blinking back a tear. And Susie put a reassuring hand on his arm. He was in here. No doubt about it.
When Marcus got home, his mother was lying on the floor with a coat draped over her, watching children's cartoons. "Didn't you go to work today?" "This morning. I took the afternoon off sick."
This wasn't right.
Something was going to have to give. He was having a shit time at school and a shit time at home. That meant he was having a shit time all the time, apart from when he was asleep. Someone was going to have to do something about it, because he couldn't do anything about it himself, and he couldn't see who else there was, apart from the woman under the coat. She was his mum. And if he felt bad, it was her job to stop him feeling bad, even if she didn't want to, even if it meant that she'd end up feeling worse. He started crying again, long, low sobs that terrified him. "You've got to stop this. I can't. You've got to. If you can't look after me properly, then you'll have to find someone who can." She rolled over and looked at him. "You're going to a picnic on Saturday," she said. "In Regent's Park. With Susie. Not that SPAT lot. I hate them. Why do I have to? Because I'm having a rest. I'm doing what you said. I'm getting someone else to look after you. Susie's much more capable than I am." Marcus liked Susie a lot. But he still didn't want to go on a picnic with her and all those horrible little kids from SPAT. The last time, when they all went to the zoo, he'd come home and told his mum he wanted a vasectomy. That made her laugh, but he'd meant it. He knew for a fact that he was never going to have children. "I could sit in my room all day playing games. You wouldn't even know I was in the house. I want you to get out. Do something normal. It's too intense here. We're not doing each other any good." For the first time since his mother had started crying, He wanted to cry too. He knew she wasn't doing him any good. But he had no idea that it worked both ways.
What a bitch! Will! You can't ring up 5 minutes in advance and change plans like that. You should have told her to...
Susie glanced around at Marcus. Strange kid they were stuck with for the day, who was humming tunelessly.
F off!
His ex, who according to Susie was called Paula, a name he must have mentioned the other night, was always going to get the blame for Ned's non-appearance at the picnic, but he felt obscurely loyal to her in the face of Susie's empathetic anger.
And the car! I can't believe she took the car!
Paula had also taken that first thing this morning, thus obliging Will to phone up Susie and ask for a lift to Regent's Park. I know. She's a cow. It was much more confusing than he'd imagined, making people up. How many times could Ned reasonably be whisked away by his mother? What reasons could he give for not inviting Susie round to his flat, where there were no toys, no second bedroom even? I don't even know what you'd do, Susie said. Megan was in the baby seat beside her. Will was in the back with Marcus. Nothing.
Oh, well, what did you do before?
Nothing. My dad wrote a song in 1938, a famous song, I Live Off the Royalties.
You know Michael Jackson, right? He makes £1 million a minute,
said the weird kid. Well, I don't, said Will.
How much, then?
Marcus, said Susie.
So what's this song?
Santa's Super Sleigh, said Will.
Really?
Susie and Marcus both started singing the same part of the song.
So just leave out the mince pies and a glass of sherry, and Santa will visit you and leave you feeling merry. Oh, Santa's super sleigh, Santa's super sleigh.
People always sang the same part. Will had friends who began every single phone call with a quick burst of Santa's super sleigh.
I expect people always do that, don't they?
You two are the first, actually. Susie glanced at him in the rearview mirror.
Sorry.
It's okay. I asked for it, really.
But how does that make money? Do carol singers have to pay you 10%?
I should do. But no, it's on every Christmas album ever made. Elvis did it, you know?
Yeah.
And the Muppets. And Des O'Connor. And the Crankies. Bing Crosby. David Bowie, in a duet with Zsa Gabor. And Val Dunican and Cilla Black and at least 100 other recording artists.
But haven't you ever wanted to work?
Sometimes. It's just, I don't know. Never seem to get around to it. Susie parked in the outer circle and unfolded Megan's buggy, while Will stood on the pavement with Marcus. Marcus had a strange, frizzy bush of hair, brand new jeans, and a Microsoft T-shirt. It wouldn't do him any harm with Susie if he were to strike up a sparky, mutually curious relationship with her friend's son. He'd work on Megan later. So, Marcus, who's your favourite footballer?
I hate football.
Right. Who are your favourite singers, then? Marcus snorted.
Are you getting these questions out of a book?
Susie laughed. Will blushed.
No,
I'm just interested.
Okay. My favourite singer is Joni Mitchell.
Joni Mitchell? Don't you like Snoop Doggy Dogg or Paul Weller?
No, don't like any of them.
Marcus looked Will up and down, taking in the trainers, the haircut and the sunglasses, and added cruelly,
Nobody does. Only old people.
Everyone in your school listens to Joni Mitchell?
Most people.
Will knew about hip-hop and acid house and grunge and Madchester and Indie. He read Time Out and ID and The Face and Arena and the NME still. But nobody had ever mentioned anything about a Joni Mitchell revival. He felt dispirited. Marcus went on ahead.
What's up with his mum?
Will asked Susie quietly.
She's just a bit under the weather.
She's going nuts, said Marcus matter-of-factly. Cries all the time, doesn't go to work.
Oh, come on, Marcus. She's just had a couple of afternoons off. We all do that when we're, you know, off colour.
Is that what you call it? Said Marcus.
I call it nuts. Well, she doesn't seem nuts to me. That's because you don't see her very often. She'll be fine, said Susie. She just needs a weekend taking it easy. When you get back tonight, she'll be rested up and ready to go. Marcus snorted and ran on. I see her at least once a week, said Susie. And I phone as well. Does he really expect more than that? I study. I've got Megan. Jesus! I don't believe all these kids are listening to Joni Mitchell, said Will. I would have read about it. I'm not that out of touch. Will felt that his apologies and explanations for Ned's absence were taken at face value by the spat picnickers. There was, he knew, absolutely no reason why they should not have been. Nobody was so desperate for an egg and cress sandwich that they would go to all the trouble of inventing a child, but he still felt a little uncomfortable, and as a consequence threw himself into the afternoon with an enthusiasm that he was only usually able to muster with chemical or alcoholic assistance. He played ball, he blew bubbles, he hid, he sought, he tickled, he dangled. He did more or less anything that would keep him away from the knot of adults sitting on blankets under a tree, and away from Marcus, who was wandering around the boating lake. After a while, Susie and Megan, asleep in her buggy, came over to join him. You miss him, don't you?
Who?
Susie smiled knowingly. And Will, on the case again, smiled back. I'll see him later. It's no big deal. He would have enjoyed it here, though. Suddenly, Marcus was in front of them, hopping from foot to foot, as if he were about to wet himself. I think I've killed a duck, he said. Marcus couldn't believe it. Dead. A dead duck. Okay, he'd been trying to hit it on the head with a piece of sandwich, but he tried to do all sorts of things, and none of them had ever happened before. And anyway, since when did hitting a bird with a sandwich ever kill it? There must have been something wrong with it. It was just a coincidence. But if it was, nobody would believe him. Will, Susie, Megan and Marcus stood on the path at the edge of the lake, staring at the dead body floating in the water. There's nothing we can do about it now, said Will. Just leave it. What's the problem?
Well, someone said they were going to tell the park keeper.
What's that floating next to it? Will asked. Is that the bread you threw at it? Marcus nodded unhappily. That's not a sandwich, that's a bloody French loaf. No wonder it keeled over. That would have killed me. Marcus hated him. Who did this Will think he was?
I'm not sure it was me.
He was going to test out his theory. If Susie didn't believe him, there was no chance the police and judges would.
I think it must have been ill. I think it was going to die anyway.
Nobody said anything. Will shook his head angrily. Marcus decided this line of defense was a waste of time, even though it's true. Susie insisted on coming back to the flat with Marcus. Will wasn't invited, but he followed them in. Then Marcus put the key in the door and opened it. And a new part of his life began. Bang! Without any warning at all. His mum was half on and half off the sofa, her head lolling towards the floor. She was white and there was a pool of sick on the carpet. The sick was grey and lumpy, and the room stank. He just stood there, but Susie dropped Megan, still in her car seat, and ran over to his mum and started screaming at her and slapping her. Susie yelled at Will to call for an ambulance and told Marcus to make some black coffee. His mum was moving now and making a terrible moaning noise. Susie was crying and then Megan started up too, so in seconds the room had gone from a terrifying silence to noisy, terrifying panic. Fiona, how could you do this? Susie screamed. You've got a kid! How could you do this? It was only then it occurred to Marcus that all this reflected badly on him. Marcus had seen some things. Mostly on video at other people's houses. He'd seen a bloke put another bloke's eye out with a kebab skewer in Hellhound 3. He'd seen a man's brains come out of his nostrils in Boil Ahead, The Return. None of it had ever stopped him sleeping or given him nightmares. This was the scariest thing he'd ever seen. And he knew the moment he walked in that it was something he'd have to think about forever. It was there on the kitchen table. Everyone had been in such a hurry last night that they hadn't noticed. He picked it up. Dear Marcus, I think that whatever I say in this letter, you'll end up hating me. There's certainly going to be a long period of time when you'll think I did a wrong, stupid, selfish, unkind thing. So I wanted to give myself a chance to explain.
Listen. A big part of me knows that I'm doing a wrong, stupid, selfish, unkind thing. The trouble is that it's not the part that controls me anymore. That's what's so horrible about the sort of illness I've had for the last few months. It just doesn't listen to anything or anybody else. It just wants to do its own thing. None of this has anything to do with you. I've loved being your mum. Always. Even though I find it difficult sometimes. And I don't know why being your mum isn't enough for me, but it isn't. There doesn't seem to be anything to look forward to, so I'd rather call it a day. I know that if I kept it all going just for your sake, you wouldn't thank me. And I reckon that once you've got over this, things will be better for you than they were before, really. You can go to your dad's, or Susie has always said she'll look after you if anything happened to me. I'll watch out for you if I'm able to. I think I will be. I think that when something happens to a mother, she's allowed to do that, even if it's her fault. I don't want to stop writing this, but I can't think of any reason to keep it going. Love you. Mum. He was still sitting at the kitchen table when she came back from the hospital with Susie and Megan. Shit, Max, I'd forgotten about that. You forgot the suicide letter. I didn't think I'd ever have to remember it, did I? She actually laughed. That was his mother. When she wasn't crying over the breakfast cereal, she was laughing about killing herself. Susie, maybe Marcus and I ought to have a little talk on our own. Susie and his mum hugged, and Susie came over to give him a kiss. She's fine, Susie whispered, loud enough for his mum to hear. Don't worry about her. When Susie had gone, Fiona put the kettle on and sat down at the table with him. Are you angry with me? What do you think? I don't feel the same as I did, if that's any help. What? It's all just gone away? All that? No, but at the moment I feel better. And the moment's no good to me. What happens when you finish your tea? What happens when I go back to school? I can't be here to watch you all the time. No, but we've got to look after each other. Shouldn't be all one way. Marcus nodded. But he had read her letter, and he was no longer very interested in what she said. It was what she did, and what she was going to do that counted. He had always trusted his mother, or rather, he had never not trusted her. But for him, things would never be the same again. Two wasn't enough. That was the trouble. He'd always thought that two was a good number, and that he'd hate to live in a family of three, or four, or five. But he could see the point of that now. If someone dropped off the edge, you weren't left on your own. How could you make a family grow if there was no one around to help it along? He was going to have to find a way. I'll make the tea, he said brightly. At least now he had something to work on. Will was somewhat distracted by the events of the weekend. For some reason, possibly because he encountered real drama very rarely in the course of an average day, he kept thinking about Marcus and Fiona, wondering how they were. Maybe Fiona and Marcus needed him more than Susie did. Maybe he could really do something with those two. Give their lives a bit of shape and gaiety. He phoned Susie. I was wondering how things are up the road, he said. Not too bad. She hasn't gone back to work, but Marcus went back to school today. How about you? Fine, thanks. Listen, do you think I could help with Marcus and Fiona? Take Marcus out or something? Maybe I could, you know, build on the other day. Why didn't I ask Fiona? Thanks. And it'd be nice to see you and Megan again soon. I'm still dying to meet Ned. We'll fix something up. So, there it was then. An enormous, happy, extended family. True, this happy family included an invisible 2-year-old, a balmy 12-year-old and his suicidal mother, but Sod's Law dictated that this was just the sort of family you were bound to end up with when you didn't like families in the first place. Will bought a time out in an attempt to find something that a 12-year-old boy might want to do on a Saturday afternoon.
He was in the process of wondering whether the British Gas Wildlife Photographer of the Year exhibition could possibly be any duller than it sounded when the telephone rang.
Hi, Will, it's Marcus.
Hi. Funnily enough, I was just wondering.
Susie said you want to take me out for the day somewhere. I'll come if my mum can come, and she hasn't got any money, so either we'll have to go somewhere cheap or you'll have to treat us.
Right. Listen, I thought it might be better just you and me. Give your mother a break.
Yeah, well...
Suddenly, belatedly, he got it. Giving Marcus's mum a break was what they'd been doing last weekend. She'd spent the time tipping a bottle of pills down her throat. Sorry, Marcus, I was being dim.
Yeah.
Of course your mum can come. That would be great. Marcus wasn't really bothered about leaving his mum on her own, because she was still in this weird, calm mood. But telling Will that he wanted his mum to come with them was a way of getting her and Will together. After that, he reckoned it should be easy. His mum was pretty, and Will seemed quite well off. They could go and live with Will and his kid, and then there'd be four of them, and four was twice as good as two, and it wouldn't matter quite so much if one of them died.
Well, it would matter.
But at least it wouldn't leave somebody. Him, or his mum, or Will, or his little boy, completely on their own. Will came into the flat before they went out. His mum looked good, Marcus thought. She was wearing her best leggings and a baggy, hairy jumper and makeup.
Thanks for all you did last weekend. I really appreciate it.
Pleasure. I hope you're feeling...
My stomach's fine.
I suppose I must still be a bit balmy, though. That sort of thing doesn't clear up so quickly, does it?
Will looked shocked. Marcus hated it when she made jokes to people who didn't know her well.
Have you decided where you want to go then, young Marcus?
Planet Hollywood.
Oh, God, really?
Yeah, supposed to be brilliant.
There were loads of people outside Planet Hollywood waiting to get in, and it was raining.
Are you sure this is where you want to go, Marcus?
His mum asked.
Yeah. Where else is there anyway?
If someone came up with an even half-decent suggestion, he'd take it. Nobody was going to get married to anybody at this rate. It was too wet and too horrible. Tell me why you want to go to Planet Hollywood, and I'll see if I can think of anywhere like it, said Will.
Because it's famous, and it's got the sort of food I like, fries and things. But it's got to be my sort of famous, not yours. It's got to be the sort of famous that kids know about.
So if I said, how about 28, you wouldn't want to go?
No, never heard of it.
But famous people go there. Actors. But they don't tell you in advance. I'll be straight with you, Marcus. We might bump into Tom Cruise and Nicole Kidman, or we might see nobody at all. But they do good fries. Thing is, we'll be standing here for an hour.
Okay.
Good man.
No famous people ever went to this 28th place. You could tell. It was nice, and the fries were good, but it was just normal.
Didn't have anything on the walls like Clint Eastwood's jacket or the mask Michael Keaton wore in Batman.
He didn't mind, though.
The main thing was that Will and his mother could begin to talk. Nobody said anything until the waiter came to take their order.
Mushroom omelette and fries, please. And a Coke, said Marcus.
I'll have the swordfish steak, said Will.
I'll have the penne pesto, said his mother, with a mixed salad.
Nobody said anything again.
Don't just sit there, Marcus said suddenly. Talk to each other.
I'm sure we will in a moment, said his mother. What do you want us to talk about? Will asked.
Anything. Politics, films, murders. I don't care.
I'm not sure that's how conversation happens, said his mother.
Maybe you should have worked it out by now. You're old enough. Marcus!
Will was laughing. He's right. We have at least 60 years of conversational experience between us, Fiona. We ought to be able to get something going.
Okay, then. After you.
They both laughed, but neither of them said anything.
Will,
said Marcus,
have you ever been married?
No, I haven't. Have you?
Of course not. I'm not old enough. Now ask Mum.
Fiona, have you ever been married?
No.
When Marcus was a little kid, he used to think that you had to be married to be a father or mother. He knew now that this wasn't true and that his parents had never been married.
Did you want to get married, Mum?
Not really. It didn't seem important. So why do other people bother? Oh, all sorts of reasons. Security, pressure from family, misguided notions of romance.
Will laughed at this. Cynic.
Marcus didn't understand this, but that was good. His mum and Will now had something that he hadn't started.
Do you still see Marcus's dad?
Not very often. Do you still see your ex?
Well, yes. Yes, all the time. She picked Ned up this morning.
He said this in a funny way, Marcus thought. Almost like he'd forgotten and then remembered. And is that all right?
We have our moments.
How come you ended up looking after Ned?
She was going through a Kramer versus Kramer kind of thing. A sort of, I want to find out who I am, malarkey.
And did she find out who she was?
Not really. I don't know if anyone really does, do they?
The food arrived, but the two adults hardly noticed. Marcus dug happily into his omelette. Would they move into Will's place, he wondered, or buy somewhere new?
Will knew that Fiona was not his type. She was clearly interested in relationships, judging from the conversation, so why didn't she make more of an effort? Why didn't she have a decent haircut? And why didn't she wear clothes which looked like they mattered to her? He didn't get that at all. And he could see now why Marcus was so weird. She believed in alternative things like aromatherapy and vegetarianism and the ecology, stuff he didn't give a shit about. He had to say that the thing he found most attractive about her was that she tried to kill herself. Now that was interesting. But how can you contemplate dating a woman who might top herself at any moment? But he didn't want to let it drop. He wouldn't have to do that much, after all. The occasional swordfish steak, the odd visit to a crappy film, how hard could that be? Helping people. That was the way forward for him now. The way he saw it, he'd helped Angie by sleeping with her. And now he was going to find out whether it was possible to help someone without sleeping with them. It had to be, surely. Within a few days, he changed his mind completely. He had no interest in good works, in Marcus and Fiona. He would break out into a cold sweat of embarrassment every time he thought of them. Singing! How could you have anything to do with someone who makes you sing? It began with an invitation to supper, and though he didn't like what they had to eat, something vegetarian with chickpeas, he quite enjoyed the conversation. Fiona told him about a job as a music therapist, and Marcus told Fiona that Will earned millions of pounds because his dad had written a song. Will helped with the washing up, and then Fiona sat down at the piano and started to play. She wasn't bad. The piano playing was better than her voice, but she could certainly carry a tune. No, it wasn't the quality that embarrassed him. It was the sincerity. Fiona meant knocking on heaven's door. And then she meant fire and rain. And then she meant both sides now. There was nothing between her and the songs. She was inside them. He knew that the evening couldn't last forever, that he would soon be home, tucked up in bed, that singing round the piano with a depressive hippie and a weirdo son wouldn't kill him. He knew all that, but he didn't feel it. He couldn't do anything with these people after all. He could see that now. When he got home, he put a Pet Shop Boys CD on and watched Prisoner, Cell Block H, with the sound down. He wanted to hear people who didn't mean it, and watch people he could laugh at. He got drunk, too. And as the drink began to take hold, he realized that people who meant it were much more likely to kill themselves than people who didn't. He couldn't recall having even the faintest urge to take his own life. He just wasn't that engaged. Fiona called him once after the excruciating supper. She left a message on the machine, but he didn't answer it. He returned to the life he'd been living before he met Angie. He went record shopping, clothes shopping, played a bit of tennis, went to the pub, watched telly, went to see films and bands with friends. Time was filled effortlessly. He'd even gone back to reading books in the afternoon. He was halfway through a James Ellroy thriller one Thursday when the doorbell went.
"I've come to see you," said Marcus.
"All right. Come in." For some reason, he felt a rising panic. Marcus sat down and stared intently at everything.
"You haven't got a kid, have you?"
"Well," said Will, You've got no toys in here. You haven't even got any photos of him. You've been lying to me and my mum and my mum's friend. Who told you where I lived? I saw you out once and followed you home. Why don't you just go home, Marcus? All right. But I'm going to tell my mum.
Ooh, I'm scared.
Will could feel himself tumbling down a hill towards the kind of panicky guilt he hadn't felt since school days, and it seemed natural to resort to the kind of phrases he used then. There was no explanation he could give Marcus, other than the truth, that he had invented a child so he could meet women. And the truth sounded much seedier than it was ever intended to be.
I'll do you a deal. I won't say anything to my mum if you go out with her.
Why do you want your mum to go out with someone like me?
I don't think you're too bad. I mean, you told lies, but apart from that, you seem okay. And she's sad, and I think she'd like a boyfriend.
Marcus, I can't go out with someone just because you want me to. I'd have to like the person as well. Go home!
Okay, but I'll be back. Marcus would have told his mum where the trainers had come from if she'd asked. But she didn't even notice he was wearing them. Trainers that seemed so big and white and attention-seeking that Marcus felt as though he was wearing something alive. A pair of rabbits, maybe. But she noticed they had gone. Spotted his socks. Typical.
Where are your shoes? He shrieked.
Stolen, he said.
Why would anyone steal your shoes?
Because they were new Adidas trainers. Will bought them for me.
Will?
Yeah. He's sort of become my friend. I go round his flat after school.
You go round his flat after school?
Well, he doesn't really have a kid.
He doesn't really have a kid!
And so on. And he was in a lot of trouble. Although not as much trouble as Will. Marcus put his old shoes back on, and then he and his mother went straight back to Will's flat. Fiona started raging at Will, and at the beginning he looked embarrassed and apologetic. He had no answers to any of her questions, so he stood there staring at the floor. But as it went on, he started to get angry too.
Okay, Fiona was saying. Now what the hell are these little after-school tea parties about? Why would a grown man want to hang out with a 12-year-old boy?
Will looked at her.
Are you suggesting that I've been fiddling with your son? I'm simply asking why you entertain 12-year-olds in your flat.
Will lost his temper.
I don't have any fucking choice, do I? Your son comes round fucking uninvited every night. Sometimes he's pursued by gangs of savages. I've been letting him in for his own safety. I won't fucking bother next time. Now you're finished. Piss off! I haven't! Why did you buy him a pair of expensive trainers? Because look at him!
They looked at him. Marcus even looked at himself.
You haven't got a clue, have you?
About what?
Marcus is being eaten alive at school. They take him to pieces every single fucking day of the week, and you're worried about where his trainers come from and whether I'm molesting him!
Marcus suddenly felt exhausted. He hadn't properly realized how bad things were until Will started shouting, but it was true. He really was being taken to pieces every single fucking day of the week. Up until now, he hadn't linked the days of the week in that way. Each day was a bad day, but he survived by kidding himself that each day was somehow unconnected to the day before. Now he could see how shit everything was, and he wanted to go to bed and not get up until the weekend.
Marcus is doing fine,
his mother said. He didn't believe she'd said it.
You're kidding, said Will.
I know he's taking some time to settle at his new school, but
I used to be a fucking kid, said Will. And I used to go to a fucking school. I know the difference between kids who can't settle down and kids who are just plain miserable. And I'm supposed to take this from someone who... Oh!
Marcus shouted.
Cowabunga!
He'd made the first two noises he could think of because he could see Will was going to bring up the hospital, and he didn't want that.
What's wrong with you?
Asked Will. Marcus shrugged. Nothing, just... I don't know... Wanted to have a shout. Will shook his head.
Jesus, he said. What a family.
You're not going round there again, Fiona said on the way home.
Why not? If you've got anything to say, you say it to me. If you want new clothes, I'll get them.
But you don't know what I need, so tell me.
I don't know what I need. Only Will knows what I need.
Don't be ridiculous.
It's true. He knows what things kids wear.
You mean that he thinks he's trendy, and that even though he's God knows how old, he knows which trainers are fashionable, even though he doesn't know the first thing about anything else?
That was exactly what he meant. We don't need that kind of person. We're doing all right our way.
Marcus looked out of the bus window.
It wasn't true. Neither of them are doing all right. If you're having trouble, it's nothing to do with what shoes you wear. I can tell you that for nothing. I know, but Marcus, trust me, okay? I've been your mother for 12 years. I know what I'm doing.
Marcus had never thought of his mother as someone who knew what she was doing. He'd always looked on being a mother, what she did with him, as straightforward, something most people could do. That there wasn't an awful lot to think about. But his mum seemed to be saying that there was more to it than that. She was telling him she had a plan. He had a choice. He could trust her, believe her when she said she knew what she was doing. That meant putting up with things at school because they'd turn out all right in the end. Believe that she could see things he couldn't. Or he could decide that actually she was off her head. Someone who took drug overdoses and then apparently forgot all about them afterwards. Either way, it was scary. He didn't want to put up with things as they were. But the other choice meant that he'd have to be his own mother. And he didn't know where to start. In the next few days, he began to notice more things about the way Fiona talked to him. Everything she said about what he could and should watch or listen to or read or eat made him curious. Was this part of the plan, or was she just making it up as she went along? It never occurred to him to ask her until she told him to go to the shops to get some eggs for their dinner. It struck him that he was a vegetarian only because she was, too. "Did you always know I was going to be a vegetarian?" She laughed. "Of course I did. I didn't decide on the spur of the moment because we'd run out of sausages. Shouldn't I have been allowed to make up my own mind?" "You can when you're older." "Why aren't I old enough now?" "Because you don't do your own cooking. I don't want to cook meat, so you have to eat what I eat." "But you don't let me go to McDonald's either." "I can't stop you going to McDonald's. I'd just be disappointed if you did." Disappointed. Disappointment. That was how she did it. Did a lot of things. "Why? I thought you were vegetarian because you believed in it. I do. Well, you can't go to McDonald's then, can you?" She always told him he could do what he wanted, and then argued with him until what he wanted was what she wanted. It was beginning to make him angry. "That's not fair." She laughed. "That's what life is, Marcus. You have to work out what you believe in, and then you have to stick to it. It's hard, but it's not unfair." There was something wrong with this, but he didn't know what. But of all the things that made him different, he could see this was the most important. It was why he wore clothes that other kids laughed at, because they'd had this talk about fashion, and they'd agreed that fashion was stupid. And why he listened to music that was old-fashioned, because they'd had this talk about modern pop music, and agreed it was just a way for record companies to make a lot of money. It was why he wasn't allowed to play violent computer games, or eat hamburgers, or do this or that or the other. And he'd agreed with her about all of it, except he hadn't agreed, really. He'd just lost the arguments. "Why don't you just tell me what to do? Why do you always have to talk about it?" "Because I want to teach you to think for yourself. But all that happens is we have an argument and I lose, and I do what you want me to do. We might as well save time. Just tell me what I'm not allowed and leave it at that. What's brought all this on? I've been thinking for myself. I've been thinking for myself, and I want to go round to Will's house after school." "You've already lost that argument." "I need to see someone else who's not you. Will's not like you." "No. He's a liar, and he doesn't do anything, and he bought me those trainers, and he understands about school. He knows things." "Marcus, he doesn't even know he's born."
"You see what I mean?" He was getting really frustrated now. "I'm thinking for myself, and you just doesn't work. You win anyway. Because you're not backing it up. It's not enough to tell me that you're thinking for yourself. You've got to show me. Give me a good reason." He could give her a reason. It wouldn't be the right reason, and he'd feel bad saying it, and he was pretty sure it'd make her cry, but it was a reason that would shut her up, and if that was how you had to win arguments, then he'd use it. "Because I need a father!" It shut her up, and it made her cry. It did the job.
November the fucking 19th. That was definitely a new record, Will noted darkly. He could see that when he was 60, he'd be hearing his first rendition of Santa's Super Sleigh in July. On November the fucking 20th, the day after November the fucking 19th, Fiona rang and started saying mad things down the phone.
Marcus doesn't need a father, and he certainly doesn't need a father figure like you.
Well, Fiona, I definitely don't need a son figure, so you and I are in complete agreement.
You won't see him, even if he wants to see you.
You seem very keen to be shot of him. Hold on. You phoned me to tell me to keep out of Marcus's way. Now you're telling me to apply for custody.
Are you incapable of conducting a conversation without resorting to sarcasm?
Just explain to me simply, without changing your mind halfway through, what you want me to do.
He sighed. Some things are a little more complicated than that, Will. I think we need to talk about this whole thing properly, don't you?
There isn't a whole thing.
Are you free for a drink tomorrow night? It would be better to talk face to face. We're not getting anywhere here.
They went to a quiet pub off the Liverpool Road. Will sat down opposite Fiona and ascertained, once again, that he did not find her in the least attractive.
I'm sorry about yesterday, he said. I was very upset when I called. When Marcus said he felt he needed some male input, I felt as though I'd been slapped. It's the first thing you think of when you split up with the father of your son, that he's going to need a man. Ever since Marcus has been old enough to understand, we've talked about it. And every time he's assured me it doesn't matter. And then yesterday it came right out of the blue. He's always known how worried I am about that. Will didn't want to get involved. But listening to Fiona, he realized that in some respects, he understood Marcus better than she did. Possibly because he was a man, and possibly because Marcus was, in his own junior and eccentric way, a devious man. Will understood devious men. That's why he said it, he said flatly. Because he knew it would do the job. That was his nuclear option. What job?
Whatever job he wanted it to do. What were you arguing about?
My opposition to his relationship with you.
Oh. That was very bad news. If Marcus was willing to go nuclear on his account, then he was in even deeper than he'd feared.
Are you saying that he was attacking me in my most vulnerable spot just so he could win an argument? Marcus isn't capable of that.
Will snorted. What planet did this woman live on?
I told you. He doesn't really need a male influence. He just said it to get his own way.
Fiona looked bleakly at her Guinness.
But why does he want to see you so much that he'd do that to me?
I don't know.
Marcus had to go and see the headmistress about his trainers. His mum had made a complaint to the school, even though Marcus had begged her not to. So he had a choice. He could lie to the headmistress, tell her that he had no idea who'd stolen his shoes, and make himself look stupid. Or he could tell her, and lose his shoes, jacket, shirt, trousers, underpants, and probably a piece of his ear on the way home. Mrs. Morrison wasn't ready for him. He could hear her through the door, shouting at someone. He was on his own at first, but then Ellie McCrae, this scruffy girl from year 10 who hacked off her own hair and wore black lipstick, sat down on the far end of the row of chairs outside the office. Ellie was always in trouble for something, usually something bad. They sat in silence for a bit, and then Marcus thought he'd try to talk to her. His mum was always on at him to talk to people at school.
Hello, Ellie, he said.
She looked at him and laughed under her breath, shook her head bitterly and then turned her face away. Marcus wished he had a video camera. He'd love to show his mum what happened when you tried to talk to another kid at school.
How come every squitty little shitty snotty bastard knows my name?
Marcus couldn't believe she was talking to him. She was still looking the other way. He decided to ignore her.
Oi! I'm talking to you! Don't be so fucking rude!
Sorry. I didn't think you were talking to me.
I don't see any other squitty little shitty bastards here, do you?
No. Marcus admitted.
So, how come you know my name? I haven't got a bloody clue who you are. You're famous.
He knew that was a mistake as soon as he'd said it.
I'm famous because I'm always in trouble.
Yes.
Fucking hell.
They sat there for a while longer.
I'm always in trouble, and I've never done anything wrong,
he said eventually.
No. How do you know?
Because you just said so.
If you're being cheeky, you'll get a slap. Do you know what I've done wrong this time? It's this sweatshirt. They don't want me to wear it, and I'm not going to take it off, so there's going to be a row.
They were all supposed to wear sweatshirts with the school logo on them, but Ellie's showed a bloke with scraggy hair and half a beard.
Who's that?
He asked politely.
Oh, that's incredible. That's like not knowing the name of the Prime Minister or something.
Yeah. Who is it, then?
Kirk O'Bain. What does he do?
Plays for Manchester United. He scored 5 goals for them last Saturday.
Wow,
said Marcus. Mrs. Morrison's door opened and 2 white-faced Year 7s came out.
Come in, Marcus,
said Mrs. Morrison.
Marcus lost his temper with Mrs. Morrison.
Bad idea, he could see afterwards. But he couldn't help it.
They started off okay.
No, he'd never had any trouble from the shoe stealers before. No, he didn't know who they were. And no, he wasn't very happy at school. But then she started talking about what she called survival strategies, and that was when he got cross.
I mean, couldn't you just try keeping out of their way? Did they think he was thick? Did they reckon he woke up every morning thinking, I must find the people who give me shit and steal my trainers so they can do more things to me? I have tried. Maybe I haven't tried hard enough. That did it.
He'd had enough and he stood up to go.
Sit down, Marcus. I haven't finished with you yet. I've finished with you. Sit down.
But he didn't. He just walked out and kept walking. As soon as he left Mrs. Morrison's office, he felt better. As if he'd let go and he was falling through space. It was an exciting feeling. And much better than the feeling of hanging on that he'd had before. He'd been pretending that everything was normal. Difficult, yes, but normal. But now he'd let go. He could see it had been everything but normal.
You don't get your shoes stolen normally. Your English teacher doesn't make out you're a nutter normally. You don't get boiled sweets thrown at your head normally. And that was just the school stuff.
And now he was a truant.
At 4:15, right in the middle of countdown, the buzzer went.
You're not supposed to be here, Will said.
I came to ask you a favour. I want you to take me and a friend to football.
Your mum can take you.
She doesn't like football.
Neither do you.
I do now. I like Manchester United.
Why?
I like O'Bain.
Who the hell's O'Bain?
He scored 5 goals for them last Saturday.
They drew 0-0 at Leeds, Marcus. There isn't a player called O'Bain.
I might have got it wrong. Something that sounds like that. He's got bleached hair and a beard and he looks like Jesus.
There's nobody who plays for Man United who looks like Jesus. How was school today?
Okay.
What did you have this afternoon?
History.
It's Wednesday today, isn't it?
Yes.
Don't you have double walking up and down Upper Street on Wednesday afternoons? Will could see Marcus beginning the slow descent towards panic.
What do you mean?
I saw you this afternoon. I drove past you on Upper Street. Looked like you were skiving.
It was Mrs. Morrison's fault. She told me to keep out of their way again.
You're losing me, Marcus. Who is Mrs. Morrison?
The head! You know they always say when I get in trouble that I should keep out of their way. She said that about the training shoe kids.
Okay, keep your hair on. Go home and tell your mum this.
Why can't you go and see Mrs. Morrison?
You're joking, Marcus. I'm not your father. I have nothing to do with you. No headmistress is going to take any notice of what I say. You've got to stop thinking I know the answer to everything, because I don't.
You know about things. You knew about the trainers.
Yeah, and what a triumph they were. You'd have been in school this afternoon if I hadn't bought you the trainers.
And you knew about Kirk O'Bain. Except I don't think he can be a footballer. Ellie was making one of those jokes that you make.
His first name's Kirk.
I think so.
Kurt Cobain, you jerk, the singer with Nirvana.
There you are, then, said Marcus triumphantly. You knew about him.
Everyone knows about him.
I didn't.
No, you didn't, but you're different, Marcus.
And my mum wouldn't. You see, you know things. You can help.
It was then, for the first time, that Will saw the kind of help Marcus needed. Fiona had given him the idea that Marcus was after a father figure, someone to guide him towards male adulthood. But that wasn't it at all. Marcus needed help to be a kid, not an adult. And unhappily for Will,
That was exactly the kind of assistance he was qualified to provide. He wasn't able to tell Marcus how to grow up or how to cope with a suicidal mother. But he could certainly tell him that Kurt Cobain didn't play for Manchester United. And for a 12-year-old boy attending a comprehensive school at the end of 1993, that was maybe the most important information of all. The following morning at school, Marcus bumped into Ellie. She was wearing her Kurt Cobain sweatshirt and standing with a friend from her class. "Kurt Cobain doesn't play for Manchester United," he told her. The girl from her class burst into hysterical laughter. "Oh, no," said Ellie, horrified. "Have they got rid of him?" "Ha-ha," Marcus said. "No, he sings for Nirvana. A friend of mine has got one of their records. Never mind." "What year is he in? I didn't think anyone in this school liked Nirvana." "He's left school. He's quite old. It's grunge, isn't it, Nirvana? I don't know what I think of grunge." He didn't either. Will had played him some Nirvana and he'd never heard anything quite like it. The two girls looked at each other and laughed louder than they'd done the first time. "And what do you think you might think of it?" asked Ellie's friend. "Well," said Marcus, "it's a bit of a racket, but it's got a good beat. And the picture on the cover is very interesting. It was a picture of a baby underwater, swimming after a dollar bill." Will had said something about the picture, but he couldn't remember what. "I think the cover has a meaning, something about society." The girls laughed.
"You're very funny," said Ellie's friend. "Who are you?"
"Marcus. Marcus. Cool name. You think so?"
"No," said Ellie's friend, and they laughed again. "See you around, Marcus."
"See you." It was the longest conversation he'd had with anyone at school for weeks.
"So we've scored," said Will when Marcus told him about Ellie and her friend. "I don't fancy yours much, though."
Sometimes he didn't understand one word Will said, and when that happened, Marcus just ignored him completely. "They said I was funny."
"You're hilarious, but I don't know if it's much to build a whole relationship on."
"Can I invite Ellie round?"
I'm not sure she'd come, Marcus.
"How old is she?"
"I don't know, 15? I'm not sure that 15-year-olds hang out with 12-year-olds. I'll bet you her boyfriend's 25, drives a Harley Davidson and works as a roadie for some band. He'd squash you like a bag, man."
Marcus hadn't thought of that. But Marcus wasn't really listening. Ellie and her friend had said he was funny, and if he could be funny once, he could be funny again. He saw them by the vending machine at school the next day. They were leaning against it and saying things about anyone who had the nerve to come up and put money in. "Hello, Ellie."
"Marcus, my man!"
"Ellie, how old is your boyfriend?" He'd only asked one question, and already he'd made the girls laugh. He knew he could do it.
"What do you want to know?"
"My friend Will said he was probably about 25 and drove a Harley Davidson and he'd squash me like a bug."
"Oh, Marcus."
Ellie grabbed him round the neck and ruffled his hair.
"I wouldn't let him."
"Good. I have to admit I was a bit worried when he said that." More laughter. Ellie's friend was staring at him as if he was the most interesting person she'd ever met.
"How old is your girlfriend anyway? She probably wants to kill me, doesn't she?"
They were laughing all the time now.
"No, because I haven't got one."
"I don't believe that. A good-looking boy like you. We'll have to fix you up."
"It's okay, thanks. I don't really want one at the moment. I don't feel ready yet."
Very sensible. Ellie and her friend Zoe came looking for him at lunchtime. He was sitting at his desk eating his sandwiches.
"Ellie! Marcus!"
Every kid in the room turned round. You could see what they were thinking. Ellie and Marcus? He felt great.
"What are you lot staring at? Marcus is our friend, ain't you, Marcus?"
"Yes," said Marcus.
"Come on then, let's go to our form room. It's a waste of time hanging out with this lot. Boring fuckers."
Marcus could see some of them start to blush, but nobody said anything.
"Okay," said Marcus. "Shall I bring anything?"
"Like what?"
said Zoe.
"A bottle?"
"No, but like... or condoms," said Ellie.
"Is that what you mean?"
"We can't have sex in our room, Marcus, even though I'd like to. There are too many people in there."
Zoe was laughing so hard that Marcus thought she might be sick.
"No, I know, I..."
"Just bring your sweet self, Marcus. We get a move on, eh?"
He was red in the face.
but he still got to walk from his desk to where Ellie and Zoe were standing while everyone else watched. And when he got there, Ellie gave him a kiss. Okay, she was making fun of him, but it didn't matter. There weren't many people in his class that Ellie would bother to spit on, let alone kiss. Ellie's form room was upstairs, and the walk made the good bit, the fucking hell Marcus and Ellie bit, last longer. One of the teachers even stopped him to ask if he was okay, as if anyone hanging around with Ellie must have been kidnapped.
"We're adopting him, sir," said Ellie.
"I wasn't asking you, Ellie. I was asking him."
"They're adopting me, sir," said Marcus. He didn't mean it as a joke, but they all laughed anyway.
"And you couldn't hope for more responsible parents," said the teacher.
"We'll take that as a compliment," said Ellie. "Thank you. We'll look after him. Have him home by midnight and all that."
"Make sure you do," said the teacher, "in one piece." Ellie made him wait outside her form room while she announced him. He could hear her shouting.
"Okay, listen, everybody. I want you to meet Marcus. The only other Kurt Cobain fan in the whole fucking school. Come in, Marcus!"
He walked in and they all laughed when they saw him.
"I didn't say I was a fan as such," he said. "I just think they have a good beat and their cover means something."
Everyone laughed again. Ellie and Zoe stood beside him proudly, as if he had just done a magic trick. They were right. He did feel he'd been adopted. Will fell in love on New Year's Eve, and the experience took him completely by surprise. She was called Rachel. She illustrated children's books, and she looked a little bit like Laura Nyro on the cover of Gonna Take a Miracle. Nervy, glamorous, bohemian, clever, lots of long, unruly dark hair. Will had never wanted to fall in love. When it had happened to friends, it had always struck him as a peculiarly unpleasant-seeming experience. What with all the loss of sleep and weight and the unhappiness when it was unreciprocated, and the suspect dippy happiness when it was working out. Lots of people, of course, would be thrilled to take their seats next to their ideal life partner, but Will was a realist, and he could see immediately that there was only cause for panic. He was almost sure that Rachel was about to make him very miserable indeed, mostly because he couldn't see anything he might have which could possibly interest her. If there was a disadvantage to the life he'd chosen for himself, a life without work and care and difficulty and detail, a life without context and texture, then he had finally found it. When he met an intelligent, cultured, ambitious, beautiful, witty, and single woman at a New Year's Eve party, he felt like a blank twit. Someone who'd done nothing with his whole life apart from watch Countdown and listen to Nirvana records. He tried to dredge his memory for a single, tiny scrap of experience that this woman might regard as worth her momentary contemplation. Because the thing was that when this Rachel woman sat down next to him at dinner, she was interested for the first 5 minutes before she'd worked him out, and in that 5 minutes, he got a glimpse of what life could be like if he were in any way interesting. "How do you know Robert?" Rachel was asking him. Robert produced television programs. He hung out with actors and writers and directors. People who knew Robert were arty movers and shakers and were almost obliged to be glamorous. I used to buy my dope off him years ago." That, unhappily, was the truth. Before Robert became a television producer, he was a dope dealer. Anyway, it didn't matter. He was the only person in the room who neither moved nor shook, and now Rachel knew it. She was talking to the person sitting on her other side. What could he reel her back with? He must have had some talent or other which he could exaggerate and dramatize somehow. It was hopeless. The most interesting thing about his life, he realized, was Marcus. That was something which set him apart. Rachel had noticed he wasn't talking to anyone and wheeled round so that it could be included in a conversation about whether there was anything new under the sun, with particular reference to contemporary popular music. Rachel said that to her, Nirvana sounded just like Led Zeppelin. "I know a 12-year-old would kill you for saying that," said Will. It wasn't true, of course. Marcus was probably not yet at the stage where he wanted to annihilate people who accused the band of being derivative. "So do I," said Rachel. "Maybe they should meet. What's yours called?"
"Marcus," he said.
"Mine's Ali. Alistair. And it's Marcus into skateboards and rap and The Simpsons and so on." Will raised his eyes skywards and chuckled fondly,
and the misapprehension was cast in concrete. And is Marcus's mother here tonight? No. Not a lie, not a lie. Marcus's mother was not there. No, we don't live together. He'd really got the hang of this truth-telling business now. He'd moved right away from lying. I'm sorry. It's okay. How about Ali's dad? Not at this table. Not in this city. Not in this country. He gives me his phone number when he moves. Right. Will had at least managed to introduce some friction into the conversation. Until he played the Marcus card, he'd kept slipping off before it even started. Now he felt as though he were climbing a mountain rather than a glacier. Which country is he in, then? The States. California. I'd prefer Australia, but there you are. At least it's the West Coast. Will reckoned he'd now heard 57 varieties of this conversation, but this gave him an advantage. He knew how it went. And go it did. No one, he decided, ever did themselves any harm by listening attentively to other people's woes. Rachel's story was, by SPAT standards, run-of-the-mill, and it turned out that she hated her ex because of who he was, rather than what he'd done to her. So why the fuck did you have a child with him? He was drunk. It was New Year's Eve. He was feeling cheeky. She laughed. Good question. No answer. You change your mind about people. What's Marcus's mother's name? Fiona. Which it was. Did you change your mind about her? Not really. So what happened? I don't know. He shrugged, and somehow managed to give a rather convincing impression of a man who was still shell-shocked. The words and the gesture were born of desperation. It was ironic, then, that they somehow managed to make a connection. Rachel smiled. In the end, I don't know, is the only honest answer anyone can give, isn't it? Because I don't know either, and I'd be kidding myself and you if I pretended any different. At midnight, they sought each other out and kissed. A kiss that was somewhere between cheek and lip. And at 12:30, just before Rachel left, they arranged to get their lads together to compare skateboards and baseball caps and the Christmas edition of The Simpsons. Ellie was at Susie's New Year's Eve party. She saw him and shouted, "Marcus!" and came over and hugged him and kissed him on the head. "What are you doing here?" he asked. "We always come here on New Year's Eve," she said. "My mum's good friends with Susie." "Which one's your mum?" "Don't ask," said Ellie. "Not now." "Why not?" "Because she's dancing." Marcus looked over at the very small group dancing in the corner where the TV usually was. There were four people, three women and a man, and only one of them seemed to be having a good time. She was sort of punching the air with her fists and shaking her hair. Marcus guessed this had to be Ellie's mum. Not because she looked like her, but because Ellie was clearly embarrassed, and this was the only dancer who would embarrass anyone. The other dancers were embarrassed themselves. "I wish I could dance like that," said Marcus. Ellie made a face. "Anyone can dance like that. All you need is no brain and crap music. I think she looks great. She's enjoying herself. Who cares whether she's enjoying herself? She looks like a total cretin." "Don't you like your mum, then?" "She's all right." "What about your dad?" "He's all right. We don't live together." "Do you mind?" "No. Sometimes. I don't want to talk about it. So, Marcus, have you had a good 1993? A moment was all it took to decide that 1993 had been totally useless. "No. You need a drink," said Ellie. "What do you want? I'll get you a drink and you can tell me about it. I might get bored and wander off, though. I'd do that." "Okay. So, what are you drinking?" "Coke. You've got to have a proper drink. I'm not allowed. If you're going to be my date for the evening, I insist that you have a proper drink." "I'll put something in the Coke, okay?" "Okay." Ellie disappeared, and Marcus looked round for his mum. She was talking to a man he didn't know and laughing a lot. He was pleased, because he'd been worried about tonight. Will had told him to watch out for his mum on New Year's Eve, and though he didn't explain why, Marcus could guess. A lot of people who weren't happy killed themselves then. He had seen it somewhere, and as a consequence, the night had been hanging over him. Ellie came back with a plastic beaker containing something which looked like Coke but smelt like trifle.
What's in it? Sherry. Is that what people drink? Coke and sherry? He took a cautious sip.
It was nice. Sweet and thick and warming.
So why has it been such a shit year?
Ellie asked.
Just... I don't know. Horrible things happened.
He didn't really want to tell Ellie what they were, because he didn't know whether they were friends or not. It could go either way with her. He might go into a form room one morning and she'd shout it all out to anyone who would listen. Or she might be really nice. It wasn't worth taking the risk.
Your mum tried to kill herself, didn't she?
Marcus looked at her, took a big gulp of Coke and trifle and was nearly sick all over her feet.
No,
he said quickly, when he'd finished coughing and swallowed the sick back down.
You sure?
Well, he said,
not positive.
Ellie burst into peals of laughter. He had forgotten that he made Ellie laugh so much, and he was grateful.
I'm sorry, Marcus. I know it's serious, but you are funny.
He started to laugh too then, little uncontrollable giggles that tasted of puke and sherry. Marcus had never had a proper talk with someone of his own age before. It was different, much easier. It turned out she'd known for ages. She'd overheard a conversation between her mum and Susie just after it happened, but didn't make the connection until much later.
And you know what I thought? I feel terrible about it now, but I was like, why shouldn't she kill herself if she wants to? But she's got me. I didn't know you then. No, but how would you like it if your mum killed herself?
Ellie smiled.
I wouldn't like it, because I like my mum, but, you know, it's her life.
Marcus thought about that. He didn't know whether it was his mum's life or not.
What about if you have kids? Then it's not your life anymore, is it?
Your dad would have looked after you.
Yeah, but, see, if your dad killed himself, nobody would say, you know, ooh, he's got a son to look after. But when women do it, people get all upset. It's not fair. That's because I'm living with my mum. If I was living with my dad, I'd think it wasn't his life either. But you aren't living with your dad, are you? At our school, there's about 1 million kids whose parents have split, and none of them are living with their dads. Stephen Wood is... Yeah, right, Stephen Wood, you win.
Even though what they were talking about was miserable, Marcus was enjoying the conversation. He wanted to keep it going, but he didn't know how because Ellie was the one who said the things that got them started. Suddenly, he remembered the thing boys were supposed to ask girls at parties. He didn't want to ask because he knew he was hopeless at it. But the alternative, to let Ellie wander and talk to somebody else, was just too horrible.
Would you like to dance, Ellie?
Ellie stared at him.
Marcus!
He started laughing again really hard.
You're so funny. Of course I wouldn't like to dance. I couldn't think of anything worse.
He knew then he should have thought of another proper question. Something about Kurt Cobain or politics. Because Ellie disappeared off somewhere for a smoke. And he had to go and find his mum. But Ellie came looking for him at midnight and gave him a hug. So he knew that even though he'd been stupid, he hadn't been unforgivably stupid.
Happy New Year, darling,
he said, and he blushed. Will had made the call, heart thumping, and wangled a Saturday lunch invitation for the pair of them. Marcus came round just after midday in a hairy jumper Fiona had given him for Christmas and disastrous canary yellow cords that might have looked cute on a 4-year-old. What did you tell your mum? Will asked him in the car on the way over to Rachel's place.
I told her you wanted me to meet your new girlfriend. She thinks you're mad.
I'm not surprised.
Listen, I've got some questions. When's my birthday?
Marcus, she doesn't suspect we're not father and son. She's not going to be trying to catch us out.
But suppose it came up. Suppose I said, Dad's promised me a new PlayStation for my birthday. And she said to you, when's his birthday?
Why is she asking me? Why isn't she asking you?
Just suppose.
Okay, when's your birthday?
August the 19th.
I'll remember, I promise.
And what's my favourite food?
Tell me, Will said wearily.
Pasta with mushroom and tomato sauce my mum makes.
Right.
And who's my mum?
Sorry?
Who's my mum?
The question was so basic and yet so pertinent that for a moment Will was completely thrown.
Your mum's your mum.
So you were married to my mum and you've split up?
Yeah, whatever.
And does that bother you? Or me?
Suddenly the absurdity of the questions got to both of them. Marcus began to giggle. A peculiar high-pitched meow that sounded nothing like himself or any other human, but proved to be extraordinarily infectious. Will launched into his own version of a giggling fit. It doesn't bother me. Does it bother you? He said eventually. But Marcus was unable to reply. He was still meowing.
Come in, both of you. Come and meet Ali.
Will had remembered every single tiny detail that Rachel had offered him that first night. He knew the names of the books she'd illustrated, and her ex's name, where he lived and what he did, and it was unimaginable that he could have forgotten Ali's name. Rachel lived just up the road from Camden Lock, in a tall, thin house full of books and old furniture and sepia photographs of dramatic, romantic Eastern European relatives. She shouted up the stairs, "Ali!" Nothing. She looked at Will and shrugged.
He's got his headphones on. Shall we go up?
Ali's bedroom door was indistinguishable from all the other bedroom doors. No skull and crossbones, no keep-out signs. Once inside, however, there was no question but that the room belonged to a boy stuck between the equally wretched states of childhood and adolescence in early 1994. Everything was there. The Ryan Giggs, Michael Jordan and Pamela Anderson posters, and the Super Mario stickers. A social historian of the future would probably be able to date this room to within a 24-hour period. Will glanced at Marcus, who was looking bewildered. Standing Marcus in front of posters of Ryan Giggs and Michael Jordan was like taking an average 12-year-old to look at the Tudors in the National Portrait Gallery. Ali himself was slumped in front of his PlayStation, headphones still on, oblivious to his guests. His mother went over and tapped him on the shoulder and he jumped.
Oh, hi, sorry.
Ali stood up, and Will immediately saw that this wasn't going to work. Ali was cool. Basketball boots, baggy skate-punk trousers, shaggy grunge hair, even an earring, and his face seemed to darken when he took in Marcus's yellow cords and hair jumper.
Marcus, Ali, Ali, Marcus, said Rachel.
Marcus offered his hand, and Ali took it almost satirically.
Ali, Will.
Will raised his eyebrows in Ali's direction. He thought Ali might appreciate the understatement.
Do you guys want to hang out up here for a while?
Rachel asked them.
Yeah.
Marcus shrugged, and for a moment, Will loved him.
Okay,
said Ali, with even less enthusiasm. Rachel and Will went downstairs. 10 minutes later, time enough for Will to have dreamed up a whole scenario whereby the four of them took a house in Spain for the summer, they had a door slam. Rachel went to investigate and came flying back into the sitting room seconds afterwards.
I'm afraid Marcus has gone home, she said.
Will decided he would correct any erroneous impressions he might have given Rachel slowly and patiently. But halfway through their first time out alone together, he was reminded of the old April Fool's Day joke about Britain changing over to driving on the right and making the changeover gradually. Either you lied or you told the truth, it appeared.
Oh,
was all Rachel said at first, when he told her he wasn't Marcus's natural father. She was trying and failing to pick up a clump of seaweed with her chopsticks.
So who is his natural father?
Well, said Will, it's a guy called Clive who lives in Cambridge.
Right. So, sorry, I'm being a bit thick here. If you're not Marcus's natural father, and you don't live with him, then, you know, how is he your son?
Yes. I see what you mean. It must look very confusing from the outside.
Tell me how it is on the inside.
It's just that sort of relationship. I'm old enough to be his father. He's young enough to be my son, so...
You're old enough to be the father of just about anyone under 20. Why this particular boy?
I don't know, just one of those things. Anyway,
tell me about your relationship with Ali. Is it as complicated as mine and Marcus's?
No. I slept with his father, and 9 months later I gave birth, and that's about it.
I'm sorry to harp on about this, but I still haven't got it all worked out. You're Marcus's stepfather, but you don't live with him or his mother. Did you ever live with Marcus's mother?
Define live with.
Did you ever have a spare pair of socks at her house? Or a toothbrush?
No.
Just no?
Yes.
Rachel simply sat there and waited. So he told her the truth, as he knew he would, and she was appalled.
I never actually said he was my son. That's what you chose to believe.
Yeah, right. It's me who's the fantasist. I wanted to believe you had a son, so I let my imagination run riot. You didn't lie, I just made it up. I thought, cute guy. If only you had a kid, a geeky son, pre-teenage if possible. And then you turned up at my house with Marcus, and bingo, I made this crazy link because of some deep psychological need in me.
It wasn't turning out as badly as Will feared it might. She was definitely seeing some kind of funny side, even though she clearly thought he was a weirdo.
You shouldn't beat yourself up about it. It could have happened to anyone. Hey, don't push your luck. If I want to be amused and tolerant, that's my business. I'm not yet at the stage where you can make jokes, too.
Sorry.
But where does Marcus come in? I mean, you obviously haven't hired him for the afternoon. There's some kind of relationship there.
She was right, of course, and he rescued a potentially disastrous evening by telling her everything there was to tell. Rachel invited him back for coffee after the meal, but Will knew that sex wasn't in the air. Or rather, there was the merest whiff, but it was emanating from him, so it didn't count. All that seemed to be coming from her was a quiet amusement and a sort of baffled tolerance. And though he was grateful for these small mercies, they were very rarely, he would imagine, precursors to any kind of physical intimacy beyond the quick hair ruffle. Rachel made coffee in great big blue designer cups, and they sat opposite each other. Rachel spread out on the sofa, Will bolt upright in an old armchair covered with some kind of Asian throw.
Why did you think Marcus would make you more interesting? She asked him.
Was I more interesting?
Yes, you were.
Why?
Because... You really want to know the truth?
Yes.
Because I thought you were sort of a blank. You didn't do anything. You weren't passionate about anything. You didn't seem to have much to say, and then when you said you had a kid...
I didn't actually say...
Yes, whatever. I thought, I've got this guy all wrong.
So there you are, then. You've answered your own question.
But I had got you wrong.
How'd you work that out?
Because there is something there. You didn't make it all up about Marcus. You're involved, and you care, and you understand him, and you worry about him. So you're not the guy I thought you were before you brought him up.
Will knew that he had somehow managed to turn himself into a single parent without even going to the trouble of fathering a child. There was hardly any point in moaning, though. It was too late for that. He'd be singing with his eyes closed soon, and there was nothing he could do about it.
For 3 or 4 weeks, nothing happened. Marcus saw Will. He saw Ellie and Zoe at school. Will bought him some new glasses and took him to have his hair cut. He discovered through Will a couple of singers he liked who weren't Joni Mitchell or Bob Marley, singers that Ellie had heard of and didn't hate. It felt as though he were changing, in his own body and in his head. And then his mum started the crying thing again. Just like before, there didn't seem to be any reason for it, and just like before, it began slowly, with the odd snuffle after dinner, which one night turned into a long, frightening burst of sobbing. A burst that Marcus could do nothing about, no matter how many questions he asked or hugs he gave her. And then, finally, there was the breakfast crying again. And he knew for sure that things were serious and they were in trouble. But one thing had changed. Back in the first breakfast crying time, hundreds of years ago, he was on his own. Now there were loads of people. He had Will, he had Ellie, he had... Anyway, he had two people, two friends, and that was some kind of improvement on before. Ellie, however, didn't seem terribly pleased to see him. She looked down and distracted, and she didn't say anything when he went to see her in the classroom at break time. Zoe was sitting next to her, holding her hand.
What's happened?
Kurt Cobain, said Zoe. Tried to kill himself. Took an overdose.
Is he all right?
I think so. They've pumped his stomach.
Good.
Nothing's good, said Ellie.
No, said Marcus. But
he'll do it, you know,
said Ellie.
In the end, they always do. He wants to die. It wasn't a cry for help. He hates this world. Marcus suddenly felt sick. The room was beginning to turn round slowly, and all the colour was draining out of it.
How do you know he wasn't just messing about? I'll bet you never does anything like it again.
You don't know him, Ellie said.
Neither do you,
Marcus shouted at her.
He's not even a real person, he's just a singer. He's just someone on a sweatshirt. It's not like he's anyone's mum.
No, he's someone's dad, you little prat, said Ellie.
It's Francis Bean's dad. He's got a beautiful little girl and still wants to die. So, you know.
Marcus did know, he thought. He turned around and ran out. He wanted to be on his own to think. So he went to the boys' toilets near the gym and shut himself in the right-hand cubicle, because it had comforting hot pipes running along the wall which he could sort of squat down on. After a few minutes, someone came in and started kicking on the door.
Are you in there, Marcus? I'm sorry. I've forgotten about your mum. It's okay, she's not like Kurt.
He paused for a moment, then unbolted the door and peered round it.
How do you know? Because you're right. He's not a real person. You're only saying that to make me feel better. Okay, he's a real person, but he's a different sort of real person. He's like James Dean and Marilyn Monroe and Jimi Hendrix and all those people. You know that he's going to die and it'll be okay. Okay for who? Not for... what's her name? Frances Bean. Yeah, it's not okay for her. It's just okay for you.
A boy from Ellie's year came in to use the toilet.
Go away,
said Ellie.
We're talking.
He opened his mouth to argue, realised who he was about to argue with, and went out again.
Can I come in?
Ellie said when he'd gone. They squashed up next to each other on the hot pipes, and Ellie pulled the door towards her and bolted it.
You think I know things, but I don't,
said Ellie.
Not really. I don't know anything about this stuff.
I don't know why he feels like he does, or why your mum feels like she does. And I don't know what it feels like to be you. Pretty scary, I should think.
Yeah.
He started to cry then. It wasn't noisy crying. His eyes just filled with tears and they started to stream down his cheeks. But it was still embarrassing. He'd never thought he'd cry in front of Ellie. She put her arm around him.
What I mean is, don't listen to me. You know more than I do. You should be telling me things about it. I don't know what to say about it.
Let's talk about something else then. But they didn't talk about anything for a while. They just sat on the pipes together, moving their bottoms when they got too hot, and waited until they felt like going back out into the world.
Will had vertigo. So he didn't like looking down because he started to get panicky, dizzy, and there was nothing he could do about it. He'd had that feeling when Marcus was asking him to do something about Fiona. Of course he should get involved, help the kid, look after him. But there were two words in particular that made him want to cover his ears with his hands. They always had, they always would, and he could see no way in which he could avoid them in any conversation with Fiona about her depression. Those two words were the point, as in, what's the point? I don't see the point. There's just no point. You couldn't have a talk about life, especially about the possibility of ending it, without bringing up the fucking point, and Will just couldn't see one. Sometimes that was okay. Sometimes you could be bombed out of your head on magic mushrooms and some arsehole would want to talk about the point and you could simply say, there isn't one, so shut up. But you couldn't say that to someone who was so unhappy that they wanted to empty a whole bottle of pills down themselves. People like Fiona really pissed him off. They ruined it for everyone. It wasn't easy floating on the surface of everything. It took skill and nerve, and when people told you they were thinking of taking their own life, you could feel yourself being dragged under with them. Keeping your head above water was what it was all about, Will reckoned. That was what it was all about for everyone. But Will was struggling way out of his depth. He needed someone buoyant to hang on to. He went to see Rachel. His relationship with Rachel was what Will considered weird. The weird thing was, they still hadn't had sex.
The subject just never came up. Never seemed to run out of things to talk about.
He wanted to be with her all the time for the rest of his life, and he couldn't look at her without being conscious of his pupils dilating to an enormous and possibly comical size. On top of which, he developed an almost irresistible urge to kiss her when she was saying something interesting. The problem was that he did want to sleep with Rachel very much, and he didn't know whether he could bear to sit there on the sofa with his eyes dilating wildly for the next 10 or 20 years, listening to her being unintentionally sexy on the subject of drawing mice. He didn't know whether his pupils could bear it, more to the point. Wouldn't they start hurting after a while? He was almost sure it wouldn't do them much good, all that expanding and contracting. But he would only mention the pupil pain to Rachel as a last resort. There was a remote possibility that she might want to sleep with him to save his eyesight, but he preferred to find another, more conventionally romantic route to her bed. Or his bed. And then it happened. That evening. For no reason that he could fathom. One moment they were talking, the next moment they were kissing, and the moment after that she was leading him upstairs with one hand and unbuttoning her shirt with the other. Ali was sleeping over at a school friend's house. If Rachel had told him at any other stage of their relationship that she was unencumbered by her psychotically Oedipal son, he would have taken it as a sign from Almighty God that he was about to get laid. But today, it didn't even register. They went into the kitchen, she made them coffee, and he found himself launching into the whole thing about Fiona and Marcus and the point.
What's the point?
Rachel echoed. Jesus! And don't say Ali. I haven't got an Ali. You've got a Marcus. It's hard to think of Marcus as the point of anything. You've met him.
He's just a bit messed up, but he adores you.
It had never occurred to Will that Marcus actually had any real feelings towards him. He knew that Marcus liked hanging out at his place and described him as a friend, but this he'd taken merely as evidence of the boy's eccentricity and loneliness. You reckon?
Of course he does.
He's still not the point, though. If I were about to stick my head in the gas oven and you told me Marcus adored me, I wouldn't necessarily take it out again. Rachel laughed. What's so funny?
Just the idea that I'd be there in that situation.
If you ended up sticking your head in the gas oven at the end of an evening, you'd have to come to the conclusion that the evening hadn't been a raging success. I would never stick my head in a gas oven at the end of an evening with you. He knew the moment he said it that it was a big mistake. He meant it, but that was precisely what provoked the hilarity. Rachel laughed and laughed until her eyes filled with tears.
That,
she said in between great gulps of air,
is the most romantic thing anyone's ever said to me.
Will sat helplessly, feeling like the most stupid man in the world. But when things calmed down again, they seemed to be in a different place. Somewhere where they were able to be warmer and less nervous with each other. Rachel sat down with him at the kitchen table.
You don't need a point. See, I was thinking about you. About how you have to be fairly tough in your head to do what you do.
What? Will was completely bewildered. What do I do?
Nothing.
That's what Will thought he did. So how come I have to be tough to do that?
Because most of us think that the point is something to do with work or kids or family or whatever. But you don't have any of that. There's nothing between you and despair. So why don't you put your head in the oven?
I don't know. There's always a new Nirvana album to look forward to, or something happening in ER to make you want to watch the next episode.
Exactly.
That's the point. ER? Jesus.
No, no. The point is you keep going. You want to. So all the things that make you want to are the point. I don't know if you even realize it, but you don't think life's too bad. You love things. Telly, music, food.
She looked at him.
Women, probably. Which I guess means you like sex, too.
Yeah. He said it grumpily, as if she'd caught him out somehow. And she smiled. I don't mind. People who like sex are usually pretty good at it.
Anyway, I'm the same. I mean, I love things. Poetry, paintings, my work, men, and sex. My friends, Ali. I want to see what Ali gets up to tomorrow. See, a few years ago, I was really, really down, and I did think about what Fiona's thinking about. I felt guilty about it because of Ali, and I knew I shouldn't be that way, but I was, and Anyway, it was always, you know, not today, maybe tomorrow, but not today. And after a few weeks of that, I knew I was never going to do it. And the reason I was never going to do it was because I didn't want to miss out. I mean, there were always one or two things that seemed unfinished. Things I wanted to follow through. Like, you want to see the next episode of ER. If I'd just finished stuff for a book, I wanted to see it come out. If I was seeing a guy, I wanted one more date. If Ali had a parents' evening coming up, I wanted to talk to his form teacher. And in the end, I realised there would always be something, and that those somethings would be enough. She laughed, embarrassed. That's what I think, anyway. Fiona must have things like that. Yeah, well, it doesn't sound like Fiona's getting the breaks. You need them, too.
Was that really all there was to it?
Probably not, Will thought. There were probably all sorts of things missing. Stuff about how depression made you tired of everything, no matter how much you loved it, and stuff about loneliness and panic and plain bewilderment. But Rachel's simple positivity was something to be going on with, and the conversation about the point created a point of its own, because there was this pause, and Rachel looked at him. And that was when they started kissing.
Why don't I talk to her?
Said Rachel.
They were the first words spoken afterwards. And for a moment, Will didn't understand what she meant at all. He was trying to trace it back to something that had taken place in the previous 30 minutes. A half hour that had left him feeling shaky and almost tearful. And had led him to question his previous conviction that sex was some sort of fantastic carnal alternative to drink, drugs and a great night out. But nothing much more than that.
She doesn't know you.
I don't see why that would matter. Might even help. And maybe you'd get the hang of it if I showed you how. It's not so bad.
Okay.
He couldn't ever remember feeling so happy. Have you been round to Will's?
His mum asked.
Yeah, I wanted to... I don't care. Your dad's hurt himself. You've got to go up and see him. He fell off a window ledge. I'm not going while you're crying all the time. I'm okay. Well, I'm not okay, but I'm not going to do anything. Promise. Is he really bad? He's broken his collarbone. And why do I have to go up? He was asking for you, Marcus. Lindsay said he was quite lucky it wasn't worse. So maybe he's having this big think about his life. He can piss off. Marcus! He's having this big think about his life. That made Marcus so angry. Why'd he never had a big think before? And why did he only want to see his son when he'd broken his collarbone? All those hundreds and hundreds of days when his collarbone was all right. Marcus had heard nothing. I'm not going, he said to his mother. He makes me sick. It wasn't until he was talking to Ellie about the window ledge that he began to change his mind. You should go and tell him what you think of him. I would, jerk. I'll come with you if you like. She laughed, and Marcus was thinking about how nice it would be to have a whole hour on a train with Ellie, just the two of them. How great it would be if he let Ellie, who was like his personal guided missile, loose on his dad. Will you come with me really, Ellie? Yeah, of course. If you want me to, it'd be a laugh.
Fiona wanted to come to King's Cross with Marcus, but he managed to talk her out of it and they said goodbye in the Holloway Road tube entrance.
The tube wasn't crowded. There's only one other person in his carriage, an old guy reading the evening paper. He was looking at the back page, so Marcus could see the front.
Rockstar Cobain Dead was the headline, and underneath, in smaller writing, Nirvana Singer, 27, shoots himself.
Marcus felt a lot of things all at once. He wondered whether Ellie had seen the paper yet, and if she hadn't, then how she'd be when she found out. And he wondered if his mum was okay, even though he knew there was no connection between his mum and Kurt Cobain because his mum was a real person and Kurt Cobain wasn't. And then he felt confused because the newspaper headline had turned Kurt Cobain into a real person somehow. And then he just felt very sad. Sad for Ellie, sad for Kurt Cobain's wife and little girl, sad for his mum, sad for himself. And then he was at King's Cross. He found Ellie underneath a departure board, which was where they'd arranged to meet. She seemed normal.
Platform 1B, she said.
Everyone was carrying an evening paper, so Kurt Cobain was everywhere and Marcus didn't know what to do.
Right,
Follow me!
Ellie shouted in a pretend bossy voice that would have made Marcus giggle at any other time. Today he didn't want to follow her, because if she was out in front, she was bound to notice the army of Kurt Cobains marching toward her.
Why don't you follow me for a change?
Oh, Marcus, you're so masterful, said Ellie. I love that in a man.
Right.
He stood directly in front of her.
Ellie, do you trust me, yes or no?
Of course I trust you.
Okay, then. Close your eyes and hang on to my jacket.
Hey?
Close your eyes and hang on to my jacket. You're not allowed to peek. Come on. I'm going to guide you through all these people, and I'm going to get you on the train, and then you'll trust me forever.
If I'll trust you forever, it won't be because I've spent 5 minutes wandering around King's Cross Station with my eyes closed.
No, but it'll help.
Oh, fucking hell, come on then.
Eyes closed, no peeking.
They set off.
Are you okay?
Marcus said over his shoulder.
Yes.
Marcus was almost enjoying it all now. The best thing about it was that he really did have to look after Ellie, and he liked the feeling that brought with it.
Are we nearly there?
Yeah.
We're out of the big station, and now we're going into the little one.
I know why you're doing this, Marcus, he suddenly said in a small, quiet voice. He stopped, but she didn't let go of him.
You think I haven't seen the paper, but I have.
He turned round to look at her, but she wouldn't open her eyes.
Are you okay?
Not really. She rummaged around in her bag and produced a bottle of vodka.
I'm going to get drunk.
Suddenly, Marcus could see a problem with his guided missile plan. The problem was that Ellie wasn't actually a guided missile. You couldn't guide her. That didn't matter so much in school, because school was full of walls and rules and she could just bounce off them. But out in the world, where there were no walls and rules, she was scary. She could just blow up in his face any time. The plan was for Rachel, Will and Fiona to go to a pub in Islington while Marcus was visiting his father. They would have a drink and a chat, and as a result of which Fiona would cheer up and lose the urge to top herself. Will arrived first. Fiona arrived shortly afterwards, distracted and slightly manic. She asked for a large gin and sipped at it nervously and quickly. Will started to feel uncomfortable. Have you heard from the boy?
Which boy?
Marcus.
Oh, him!
She laughed.
No, he'll leave a message while I'm out, I should think. Who's your friend, Rachel? Why do you want me to meet her?
Oh, I just thought you might find her interesting.
Will this happen every time you meet somebody? I have to see them for a drink, even though I don't really know you, let alone them.
No, not every time. I'll weed out the rubbish.
Thank you.
And still no Rachel. She was now 15 minutes late. After a peculiar and pointless conversation about John Major's shirts, Rachel was 30 minutes late. I'll phone her. He went to the payphone, got the answer phone, and went back to his seat. She'd never intended to come. He realized with terrible clarity that he'd been set up. But when Rachel had said he would get the hang of it if she showed him how, this is what she'd meant. He felt a rising panic. Another silence, and then Fiona started crying. Her eyes filled up and started to leak down her face, and she just sat there quietly like a kid oblivious to a runny nose. What's the matter? He tried to say it as if he knew it were a big question, but it came out all wrong. It sounded to him at least like tetchiness.
Nothing. Nothing's the matter. I'm just like this.
Existential despair, right?
Yeah, right.
He'd used the phrase to prove that he knew it, and it sounded flip and pseudo and shallow.
I don't know if there's a lot of point in talking about this with you,
she said,
but you're the only one here. I'm sorry for being like this, and being like this with you.
I'm used to women being like this with me. This is how I spend most evenings. Fiona smiled politely, but suddenly Will felt sick of himself. He wanted to find a way into the conversation, but there didn't seem to be one. And there never would be while he was stuck with his brain and his vocabulary and his personality. I'm the one who should apologize, he said. I want to help, but I know I won't be able to. I haven't got the answers to anything.
That's what men think, isn't it? But unless you've got some answer, unless you can say, oh, I know this bloke in Essex Road who can fix that for you, then it's not worth bothering.
That was precisely what he thought.
I know there's nothing you can do. I'm depressed. It's an illness. It just started. Well, that's not true. There were things happening that helped it along, but...
And they were away.
It was easier than he could possibly have anticipated.
All he had to do was listen and nod and ask pertinent questions.
He'd done it before, loads of times, with Angie and Susie and Rachel, but that was for a reason. There was no ulterior motive here. He didn't want to sleep with Fiona, but he did want her to feel better. And he hadn't realised that in order to make her feel better, he had to act in exactly the same way as if he did want to sleep with her. He didn't want to think about what that meant. He learned a lot of things about Fiona. He learned that she hadn't really wanted to be a mother, and that sometimes she hated Marcus with a passion that worried her. He learned that she worried about her inability to hold down a relationship. He learned that her last birthday had scared her to bits because she hadn't been anywhere, done anything. None of it amounted to anything enormous, but the sum of her depression was much greater than its parts, and now she had to live with something that tired her and made her see everything through a greeny-brown gauze. And he learnt that if someone were to ask her where this thing lived, she would say that it was in her throat, because it stopped her from eating and made her feel as though she were constantly on the verge of tears, when she wasn't actually crying. And that was it, more or less. What Will had been most frightened of, apart from Fiona asking him about the point, was that there was going to be a cause of all his misery, some dark secret or some terrible lack. And he was one of the only people in the world who could deal with it, and he wouldn't want to, even though he would have to anyway. But it wasn't like that at all. There was nothing. If life, with its attendant disappointments and compromises and bitter little defeats, counted as nothing. But it probably didn't. They got a taxi back to Fiona's place. The cabbie was listening to GLR and the disc jockey was talking about Kurt Cobain. It took Will a while to understand the strange, muted tone in the DJ's voice. What happened to him? Will asked the cabbie.
Shot himself in the head. Boom!
Will wasn't surprised, particularly. He knew that pop stars committing suicide were all grist to the mill. And the only consequence of Kurt Cobain's death, as far as he was concerned, was that Nevermind would sound a lot cooler. Ellie and Marcus weren't old enough to understand that, though. They would think it all meant something, and that worried him.
Isn't he the singer Marcus liked?
Fiona asked him.
Yeah.
Oh, dear.
Suddenly, Will was fearful. I'm not being funny, but, can I come in with you to listen to Marcus's answer phone message? I just want to hear that he's okay. But he wasn't, really. He was calling from a police station in a place called Royston. And he sounded a little, and frightened, and lonely.
On the train, every now and again, Ellie would give a small sob, or threaten to press the emergency stop button, or threaten to do things to the people who looked at her when she swore or swigged from her bottle of vodka. Marcus felt exhausted.
Why does it matter so much?
He asked her quietly.
I loved him.
You didn't know him. Of course I knew him. I listened to him sing every single day. I wear him every single day. The things he sings about, that's him. I know him better than I know you. He understood me. He understood you. How did someone you never met understand you? He knew I felt, and he sang about it.
So what were you feeling?
Angry! What about? Nothing, just... life, it's shit!
Marcus thought about that. And he realised that Ellie spent her whole time wanting life to be shit, and then making life shit by making things difficult for herself. School was shit because she wore her sweatshirt every day, which she wasn't allowed to do, and because she shouted at teachers and got into fights. But what if she didn't wear her sweatshirt and stopped shouting at people? How shit would life be then? Not very, he thought.
Is that really true, Ellie?
Do you really think life is shit?
Of course!
Why?
Because the world is sexist and racist and full of injustice!
Marcus knew this was true, but he wasn't convinced that this was what made Ellie angry.
And is that what Kurt Cobain thought?
I don't know. Probably. So you're not sure that he felt the same way as you? Do you feel like shooting yourself?
Of course! Sometimes, anyway.
Marcus looked at her. That's not true, Ellie.
How do you know?
Because I know how my mum feels. And you don't feel like that. You'd like to think you do, but you don't. You have too good a time.
I have a shit time!
No. I have a shit time. Apart from the time I spend with you. And my mum has a shit time. But you... I don't think so. You don't feel anything like my mum, Ellie. You shouldn't say that you feel like killing yourself when you don't. It's not right. Ellie laughed, her low, nobody-understands-me laugh. And when the train pulled in at Royston, Ellie stood up and jumped off. With a horrible, sick feeling, Marcus jumped off after her.
What are you doing? I don't want to go to Cambridge. I don't know you're dead. Everything's different there.
He followed her out of the station and onto the high street. They walked past a Tesco and came to a record shop which had a big cardboard cutout of Kurt Cobain in the window.
Look at that,
said Ellie.
Bastards! They're trying to make money out of him already!
She took off one of her boots and threw it at the glass as hard as she could. She cracked it first time.
Shit, Ellie!
She used the boot as a hammer, carefully smashing a hole big enough to lean through without hurting herself, and rescued Kurt Cobain from his record shop prison.
There! He's out!
She sat down on the curb, holding Kurt to her as if he were a ventriloquist dummy, and smiling to herself. His dad and Lindsay were the first to turn up at the police station. His dad was grumpy and in pain. He didn't look like a man who'd had a big think, and he certainly didn't look like a man desperate to see his only son. The policewoman left them alone. Clive slumped on a bench that ran along one side of the room, and Lindsay sat down next to him.
That was just what I needed. Thank you, Marcus.
He didn't do anything, said Ellie impatiently. He was trying to help me.
And who are you?
I'm Eleanor Toya McCrae.
What are you doing messing around with Marcus?
I'm not messing around with him. He's my friend. He asked me to come with him because he wasn't looking forward to heart-to-heart with a father who abandoned him at a time when he needed him most. Great, aren't they, men? You've got a mother who wants to top herself and they're not interested, but they fall off a fucking window sill and suddenly you're summoned for a talk about the meaning of life!
Marcus slumped on the table and put his head in his hands. He was suddenly very tired. He didn't want to be with any of these people.
I suppose you blame me for all this, said his father. I suppose you think that if I'd stayed with your mother, you wouldn't have gone off the rails. And you're probably right.
He sighed, and Lindsay took his hand and stroked it. Marcus sat bolt upright.
What are you talking about? All I did was get off a train.
His tiredness had been replaced by anger.
What's going off the rails about getting off a train? Ellie's off the rails. She's nuts. She just broke a window because it had a photo of a pop star in it. But I haven't done anything. And I don't care if you left home or not. It doesn't make any difference to me. I'd have gone off the train if you were still with Mum because I wanted to try and look after my friend. I suppose you are a useless father, and that doesn't help a kid very much, but you'd have been a useless father wherever you were living, so I don't see what difference it makes.
Ellie laughed.
Yay, Marcus, cool speech.
You poor kid, said Lindsay.
And you can shut up,
said Marcus. Ellie laughed even harder.
Can we go now?
She asked.
We have to wait for your mother, said Clive. She's coming with Fiona. Will's driving them up.
Oh, no,
said Marcus.
Fucking ill,
said Ellie.
Will rang Rachel from Fiona's flat, and this time she answered the phone. You were never going to come, were you?
No. I thought it might do you some good. Did I do a terrible thing?
I guess not. I guess it did do me some good.
So there you are.
But as a general rule, I'll turn up when I say I'm going to.
Thank you.
He told Rachel about Marcus and Ellie, and the moment he'd put the phone down, Ellie's mother, Katrina, called and spoke to Fiona. Then Fiona spoke to Clive, and then she called Katrina back to offer her a lift to Royston with them. Ellie's mum was an attractive woman in her early 40s, youthful-looking enough to get away with the leather biker jacket she was wearing. She had a shock of curly, hennaed hair, and she seemed to have given up on her daughter a long time ago.
She's mad,
Katrina said with a shrug as soon as she got into the car.
I don't know how or why, but she is. It's funny,
because when Ellie was born, I really hoped she'd turn out like this, feisty and rebellious and loud and bright. That's why I called her Eleanor Toya.
Is that something classical?
Fiona asked. No, it's pop, said Will. Toya Wilcox.
And now she is feisty and rebellious. I'd give anything for her to be mousy and home every night. She's killing me.
Will was not surprised to find that the vibes in the police station were bad. But he was surprised to find these vibes were coming not from the front desk, but the interview room, where there was a frosty silence and a lot of angry glares. Lindsay and Clive were glaring angrily at Marcus, who was glaring angrily at the wall. A furious teenage girl was glaring angrily at anyone brave enough to catch her eye.
You took your time,
said Ellie, when her mother walked in.
I took as long as it takes to make a phone call and drive here, said Katrina. So don't start.
Your daughter, said Clive, has been insulting and aggressive. And your son, he went on, nodding at Fiona, has clearly been mixing with the wrong crowd.
He told me to shut up, said Lindsay.
Diddums, said Ellie. The policewoman, who'd shown them in, was beginning to let her enjoyment show in her face.
Are we allowed to go? Will asked her.
Not yet. We're waiting for the shop owner to come down.
Good, said Ellie. I want to give him a piece of my mind.
It's a her, actually, said the policewoman. Ellie blushed.
Doesn't matter. She's sick.
Why is she sick, Ellie? Asked Katrina.
Because she's exploiting a tragic event for her own gain, said Ellie. She has no idea what today means. She just thinks there's a few quid in it.
Why is she coming anyway? Will asked the policewoman.
It's something we're trying here. Criminals face to face with victims of crime, so they get to see the consequences of their actions.
A nervous-looking young woman in her late 20s was shown into the room. She was wearing a Kurt Cobain sweatshirt and lots of black eye makeup, and if she wasn't Ellie's older sister, genetic scientists would want to know why not.
This is Ruth, who owns the shop. This is the young lady who broke your window, said the policewoman. Ellie looked at the shop owner, bewildered.
Did they tell you to do that?
What?
Look like me.
Do I look like you?
Everyone in the room, including the police, laughed.
You put that picture in the window to exploit people, said Ellie, with noticeably less confidence.
Picture of Kurt? It's always been there. I'm his biggest fan. His biggest fan in Hertfordshire, anyway.
You didn't just stick it in today to make some money?
Make some money out of all the grieving Nirvana fans in Royston, you mean? That would only work if it was a picture of Julio Iglesias. Ellie looked embarrassed.
Is that why you broke the window?
Ruth asked.
Because you thought I was exploiting people?
Yeah.
Today has been the saddest day of my life. And then some little idiot breaks my window because she thinks I'm trying to rip people off. Just grow up.
Will doubted very much whether Ellie was lost for words too often. But it was clear that if you wished to reduce her to a gaping red-faced mess, all you had to do was find a 20-something doppelganger whose commitment to Kurt Cobain was even more devout than her own.
I'm sorry, she whispered.
Yeah, Will, said Ruth. Come here. And Ruth opened her arms, and Ellie walked over to her and hugged her. It seemed to have escaped Fiona's notice that this embrace should have marked the end of the whole sorry cardboard cutout affair. She walked around the table, put her arms around Marcus from behind, and addressed the policewoman with an embarrassingly emotional intensity.
I haven't been a good mother to him, she declared. I've let things slide, and I haven't been noticing properly, and I'm not surprised things have come to this.
Things haven't come to anything, Mum, said Marcus. I haven't done anything. Fiona ignored him.
I know I don't deserve a chance, but I'm asking for one now. I'm appealing to you as a mother. If you give us another chance, you won't regret it.
We don't need a chance, Mum. I haven't done anything wrong. I only got off a train. Will had to hand it to Fiona. Once she decided to fight for a child, she was unstoppable. However wrong-headed the decision and inappropriate the weapons. It was a turning point of sorts. You could imagine this woman saying all kinds of inappropriate things at peculiar times. But it was getting much harder to imagine finding her sprawled off a sofa covered in sick.
Wanting Rachel so much still frightened Will. At any time, it seemed to him, she might decide that he was too much trouble or worthless or no good in bed. She might meet someone else. She might die without warning in a car crash. He felt as if he were a chick whose egg had been cracked open, and he was outside in the world, shivering and unsteady. He wasn't even sure what good all this fear was doing him. All he knew was there was no going back. That part of his life was over. Most Saturdays, Will took Ali and Marcus out somewhere. The first couple of outings had been difficult because, for some reason, he'd tried to do the education thing, and he'd taken them to the British Museum and the National Gallery, and all three of them had been bored and tetchy. But right when he was on the verge of abandoning the whole idea, Will had taken them to one of those dumb summer movies that were pitched at kids, and all three of them had had a great time. So now, it was a regular thing. Marcus was older than Ali now. The first time they'd met, when Marcus had been Will's son for the afternoon, Ali had appeared to be Marcus's senior by many years, but his explosion that day had blown his cover, and Marcus had moved on in the intervening months. He'd dressed better. He'd won the argument with his mother over whether he should be allowed to go shopping with Will, and he had his hair cut regularly. And he tried very hard not to sing out loud. And his friendship with Ellie and Zoe, which, much to everyone's surprise, had endured and deepened, meant that he was more teenage in his attitude. Even though the girls prized and cherished his occasional eccentricities, Marcus was beginning to tire of their whoops of delight every time he said something daft. And he had, sadly in a way, but inevitably and healthfully, become more circumspect when he spoke. Will missed him.